The scripture lesson today comes from Luke 1, 26 through 38. When Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a city in Galilee, to a virgin who was engaged to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David's house. The virgin's name was Mary. When the angel came to her, he said, "Rejoice, favored one, the Lord is with you." She was confused by these words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, Mary. God is honoring you. Look, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father. He will rule over Jacob's house forever, and there will be no end to his kingdom." Then Mary said to the angel, "How will this happen, since I haven't had sexual relations with a man?" The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come over you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the one who is to be born will be holy. He will be called God's Son. Look, even in her old age, your relative Elizabeth has conceived a son. This woman, who was labeled unable to conceive, is now 6 months pregnant. Nothing is impossible for God." Then Mary said, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me just as you have said." Then the angel left her. Let's pray. Dear God, may my words be of you, and those words that are not of you, may they fall upon deaf ears. Amen. Well, I failed you all in a promise. It's very sad. I've only talked about football about once this season. I promised you I would talk about football a lot, and I have not so far. And if you have not been following college football, or if you have been following college football, you might know why. If you haven't been following college football, I am a Carolina Gamecocks fan. And I didn't really feel like talking about Carolina Gamecocks football on Sunday morning. Didn't feel very holy to me after this season. And so I had a lot of hope this season. I went down to the first game. Many of you know I went down to the Texas A&M game and was really excited to spend time with my mom. And I was very excited for that. And that's the only good thing that happened that day. We left fourth quarter. It was that bad. Not because we were winning, just in case that's not clear. So the second game comes along and we play Georgia. And, you know, Georgia's always a pretty big game for us. And so we won that game and I had a little bit of hope, right? We won that game. And so I was like, okay, maybe A&M was a fluke. Maybe A&M is just that good. And we beat Georgia. So then the season goes on and we lose to schools like Tennessee and Kentucky. If you don't lose to Kentucky, don't lose to them in football. I mean, basketball, okay, but football. And so I gave up hope for the season, and I must admit I got to the second-to-last game. This is where Clayton's going to give me a hard time about our last game, but second-to-last game was a good one. And I, you know, at this point, my Saturday routine was pretty much I worked all day on Saturday and avoided the TV at all costs at the point that the Florida game came around, which is not like me. But so I get to the Florida game, and I was kind of flipping back and forth, and once again, we started losing. And so I was like, okay, it's time for me to go take a shower because clearly we're not going to do anything here. And I come out, and at some point while I was showering, we started winning. I don't know how it happened. I didn't watch the game. I've watched replays now, but we at some point ended up getting neck and neck with Florida. And then a miracle upon miracles happens, and we fumble a ball into the end zone. Only we could win by fumbling a ball into the end zone. You know, like, who does that? And it was absolutely a miracle. And if you see the replay, you will see it was a low snap, so the snap was barely made it to the hands, and then he fumbles it into the end zone as well, twice, two fumbles in the same play, and that's how we won. It was a miracle upon miracles. Now, we can justify those miracles, right? We can say that poor Muschamp, just it wasn't his year. We can say that Steve Spurrier was a better football coach, which clearly he is, But, you know, we can justify all these things. Florida had a bad day. South Carolina had a good day, or at least not as bad of a day as Florida, of course. And we can kind of justify this. And don't get me wrong, I don't think that God sits up there and cares who wins the football game. I don't think that he picks or chooses sides. Although I do choose to believe that God sits up there with Jesus on the couch with their pizza and wings and actually watches the game. Because that at least makes me feel a little more justified when that's how I spend my Saturdays. Though I don't think that he really picks sides, but at some point in our lives, in our adult lives, we have decided that we're going to justify every miracle that happens. South Carolina was an awful team this year, and somehow by miracles, we ended up beating Florida, of all people, when we couldn't beat Kentucky and Tennessee. But we can justify those miracles, right? So about a month ago, we had a healing service over at Brown Summit. Several of you went over there as well. And when I was planning for this healing service, I wasn't really sure what I believed in miracles. Now, I know other people who have had healing services or have been healed and have healed others, and I just wasn't really sure how I really felt about it. After all, I mean, it seems a little weird to us in modern day. We might read the stories and we might look at the Bible and we might see those stories and really think that we believe them, but how often do we really believe that they happen today? And so I went in and I was a little blocked. And so I called a mentor of mine, Talbot Davis. I've talked about him before. He's at a church in Charlotte. And I asked him, because they do a healing service, I said, Talbot, how do you structure it? How do you do things? How do you make this healing service work? And he said, I don't do anything. You know, yes, the band tends to play sometimes, but sometimes they don't. Sometimes I'll pray with people, but sometimes I won't. But the thing that I do every time is that I remind the congregation that I'm not the one who does healing. I'm not the one who is the healing hands. I'm not the one who actually can provide those services. I don't even have a medical degree that I could cure someone even if I wanted to. It's not my hands that heal, but it's God's hand, God that heals through me. And it's that miracle upon miracles that has had him see many, many, many people get healed through that healing service. You see, it's not our hands actually that heal. And so this passage is a reminder of two of God's miracles, the conception of Jesus and also the birth, the conception of Elizabeth's child as well. We have this reminder of God's miracles, and this time of year we hear this story all the time. It's a very common one to us. We know the story of Jesus' birth. Yes, it was Mary. Yes, it was Joseph. Yes, this is how it happened. We hear it over and over and over, and I wonder at what point we have gotten numb to the miracle of it. How do we picture someone? How can we put our bodies in the place of Mary? What would it feel like for us if we were the ones who was visited by Gabriel that night? She was probably a little scared. She was probably a lot scared. She was probably a lot in wonder. Didn't really know what this thing meant or what this thing did or how exactly she had been picked. And we have to remember that Mary wasn't exactly something special. She wasn't a queen or a princess. She was no Kate Middleton. She just was a plain and ordinary girl. And she had plans. She had plans to marry Joseph. She had plans to build a wife. She probably had plans for children. And so when she comes and is visited, she's a little shocked. She's a little in wonder of how this happened. It's a miracle. I don't know about you, but if it were me, I would probably find a way to justify the miracle. I would probably find a way to explain away things. And in fact, many scholars now do try and explain away this miracle. If I were you, if I were her, I wouldn't believe it. But that final line that says, yes, use me, I am a servant of yours, it's an important one. Because Mary's not the one who did the miracle. She was just the catalyst for it. She was the body. It was God working through her, this ordinary person, that created this amazing miracle. God uses ordinary people for extraordinary miracles. You just have to get out of the way and allow him to do it. There's this man that I see every now and then. In fact, probably most of you have seen him as well. He's a man who sits outside the Target on Battleground with a sign. And I don't know if he's homeless. I could assume that he is. But he holds up a sign and asks for money and asks for food. And if you're anything like me, I don't know. But I drive by him all the time. And sometimes I think in my head, maybe next time I'll stop at Panera. Maybe next time I'll bring him food. But for the most part, I just drive by him. And it's gotten to this point where I just don't even pay attention anymore, or I look the other way and make sure that I don't make eye contact. But the other day I passed him and I started thinking about his story, wondering about his story, and I hope that one day I have the guts to actually get out of the car and ask him for it. But I started daydreaming about what I think his story might be. And there's this thing that happens, and there have been studies that have surrounded this whole issue of poverty and the cycle of poverty. And there's this thing that happens when someone is in poverty, when someone is homeless, where they can only think about the current day. They can't get past the current day to tomorrow. They don't plan ahead. They don't have a 401k. They don't have savings accounts. They don't have plans for the future. Their mode of thinking is survival. It's the current day. And so I started thinking about this man who sits on a corner and spends all day long asking people for food and money. He doesn't go looking for jobs. He doesn't spend that time writing resumes. He doesn't spend time knocking on doors. And I wonder why. I wonder if it's a loss of hope. I wonder if it's that he knows that it's going to take many resumes and many knocks on doors and many interviews to get him a job. And I think, and I wonder, if it's that he's waiting on a miracle that he's lost hope for. You see, God can use you for extraordinary miracles as well. But God can use you for the ordinary ones. God can use you to give hope to someone who's forgotten about miracles. God can use you to help someone believe in miracles again. What if, I thought, that man did receive a little touch of kindness? What if he received a little money? What if he received a little food? But what if more? What if he was given hope? What if he was given a suit? What if he was given a job? What if he was given whatever it is that he needs to find hope again? I can give you numerous stories, but I think that you could probably all think of someone who needs a little hope in miracles this season. We have several new widows and widowers in the community that need you to go and hold their hand to tell them that you're there, that they're not alone. We have people who are scraping by. We have a family that we've sponsored and various things, but we have a family who needs hope for Christmas. They need Christmas presents, and they need to believe in Christmas again. If you look hard enough, you can find the miracles. But if you look hard enough, you can also find ways to show hope of miracles to someone in need who's lost that hope. Advent and Christmas is a time for sharing those miracles with others. It's a time for reminding people that sometimes it might be a fourth quarter save, but that save will come. There is hope in our Christ and our Savior, and the one who was and is to come, who loved us so much that he was willing to die for us. Not just me and not just you, but the entire world. The homeless man on the street, the widows, the widowers, those who need a little extra hope this season. Amen.